Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Pampered to Death by Laura Levine. Narrated by Brittany Pressley.
Chapter 1.
Driving with my cat Prozac gives new meaning to the words hell on wheels. On the day my story begins, she was at her very worst. Crouched in her travel carrier on the passenger seat of my car, wailing at the top of her lungs. Are we there yet? 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 And I hadn't even put the key in the ignition. Can't you please be quiet? I begged. She glared up at me from her deluxe, Sherpa-lined carrier and erupted in a fresh batch of wails. This screeching would go on for hours, but I could not afford to let Prozac out of her carrier, not unless I was prepared to have her pee on the upholstery and do the cha-cha on the gas pedal. I have learned from bitter experience and near-fatal accidents never to allow my frisky feline to roam free in a moving vehicle. I did my best to tune her out as I started the car and focused on my destination. Believe it or not, I, Jaine Austen, a gal whose idea of a spa treatment is a soak in the tub with my good buddy Mr. Bubble, was headed up the California coast to the Haven, a swelligant spa for the rich and pampered. This fabulous treat was a gift from my next-door neighbor, Lance Venable. Mind you, Lance does not normally go around showering me with expensive gifts, or any gifts for that matter. But this was his way of thanking me for getting him off the hook for murder. A fascinating tale which you can read all about in Death of a Trophy Wife, now available in paperback at all the usual places. Not only did Lance foot the bill for an all-expenses-paid week at the Haven, he'd also forked over extra bucks so Prozac could stay with me. A gesture I sorely wished he hadn't bothered to make. Still trying to tune out her piercing wails, I thought back to the day Lance had given me my gift. We were sitting on his living room sofa, sipping Diet Cokes and snacking on corn chips. I suppose you're wondering why I asked you to stop by, he said. You got something stuck in your garbage disposal and you want me to put my hand down to find it? One of his favorite requests. No, silly, I bought you a present. He reached behind a sofa cushion and took out a beautifully wrapped gift box. Just a little something for saving my life. You shouldn't have, Lance, I demurred. Of course, I didn't mean it. If it hadn't been for me, he'd be sitting in jail in a most unflattering orange jumpsuit. Eagerly, I clawed at the box's silk ribbons, hoping for a pair of dangly earrings or maybe a bottle of fancy perfume. Ripping it open, I peeked inside. Oh, my smile froze. A piece of paper, how nice. Read it, he said. It's a gift certificate to the Haven. The Haven? Wow, that's fabulous, Lance. Just terrific. You have no idea what the Haven is, do you? No, I confessed. It's one of the most exclusive spas in the country. You're going to spend an entire week lolling in the lap of luxury, having each and every one of your clogged pores deep cleaned. I wasn't so sure about the pore cleaning thing, but a week of lolling sounded darn good to me. Oh, Lance, how can I ever thank you? You can start by passing me the chips. I passed him the bowl of reduced sodium, low-fat, cardboard posing as corn chips. Lance insists on eating all sorts of ghastly low-cal food, an enthusiasm I do not share. When it comes to calories, my motto has always been the more the merrier. Eventually, we polished off our Diet Cokes and I bid him a fond farewell. Next time I see you, I promised, I'll have the cleanest pores in all of Los Angeles. And now, just days later, I was on my way to the Haven. True, Prozac continued to whine nonstop for the next 237 miles, but I didn't care. I was about to spend a week luxuriating in manis, massages, and poolside margaritas. Or so I thought. Little did I know that also on the schedule was a little thing called murder. Chapter 2. At first glance, the haven was indeed quite havenly. A sprawling Spanish-style hacienda with red tile roof and magnificent arched windows. It stood beneath a canopy of pines high in the hills of a rustic town on the central coast of California. It was smaller than I'd expected, more like a private residence than a resort hotel. But that made it all the more charming. I pulled my Corolla into a gravel parking lot at the side of the house, and for the first time in hours, Prozac finally stopped wailing. "We're here, honey bunny." She glared up at me from her carrier. "I want a divorce." With no parking attendant in sight, I grabbed Prozac's carrier and my suitcase and made my way to the front door, stepping into a soaring two-story reception area. An elaborate wrought-iron staircase wended its way to the second floor. Nestled in a nook beside the staircase was the spa's receptionist, a middle-aged woman who wore her graying blonde hair in a thick braid down her back. She was on the phone as I walked in, but mouthed that she'd be right with me. "Our spa package starts at $400 a day," she was saying to her caller, "depending on your accommodations." $400 a day? I almost fainted dead on the spot. Apparently, so had the caller. "Yes, I know it's a little high, but it's well worth it. No, I'm afraid we don't offer AARP discounts." While the receptionist yakked about shiatsu massages and aromatherapy, I took a look around. To my left was a dining room, set with crisp white linens, and to my right, a spacious lounge with an exposed wood-beam ceiling and a fireplace big enough to park my Corolla. "Well, give us a ring when you're ready to make a reservation," the receptionist said as she wrapped up her call, clearly unhappy to have let a customer slip through her fingers. Probably worked on commission. Then she turned to me with a bright smile, the kind they teach you in bed and breakfast school. "Welcome to the Haven." When she got up to shake my hand, I saw she was nearly 6 feet tall, with the shoulders of a Valkyrie, a middle-aged poster girl for Triumph of the Will. "I'm Olga Truitt, owner and proprietor." How odd that the owner was manning the reception desk. At a ritzy joint like this, I'd expect her to have minions aplenty to answer the phone. "You must be Jaine. I recognized you from your Cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs t-shirt. The fellow who made your reservations told me about your appalling taste in clothes." Okay, so she used the word eccentric instead of appalling, but I knew darn well what Lance must have told her. For some insane reason, Lance insists moths come to my closet to commit suicide. "This must be your kitty," she said, kneeling down to get a better look at Prozac. "Let's get her out of that cage." "I wouldn't if I were you," I warned as Olga reached for the latch on the carrier. "I'm afraid she's a little cranky right now," which was, of course, the understatement of the millennium. At that moment, Prozac was a cross between Godzilla and a Real Housewife of New Jersey. "Don't be silly," Olga said, flipping open the latch. I cringed in dismay as she reached inside, imagining her chiseled cheekbones crisscrossed with bloody scratches. But Prozac, as she often is with strangers, was a perfect angel. She leaped into Olga's arms like her long-lost daughter and stared up at her lovingly. "Thank heavens you've rescued me. You can't imagine how this dreadful woman mistreats me."
"Somebody here could stand to lose a few pounds," said Olga, bouncing her in her arms.
"You're telling me. You should see how she eats between meals. I'm surprised she can still fit into her elastic waist jeans."
"Let me show you to your room."
Olga lifted my heavy suitcase as if it were a feather duster. With Prozac nestled in one arm and my suitcase in the other, she led the way down a hallway to a series of bedrooms at the rear of the house. Once more, I was puzzled. Since when do owners of fancy-dancy spas have to tote their guests' suitcases?
Don't they have bellhops for stuff like that? And as we walked down the corridor, I couldn't help but notice that the walls could have used a touch of fresh paint.
We pride ourselves on a very intimate atmosphere here at the Haven, Olga said, catering to just a handful of guests.
She stopped at one of the carved wooden doors along the hallway and opened it with an old-fashioned key.
Here we are, she said, ushering me inside.
Aside from a slightly threadbare bedspread, it was a beautiful, high-ceilinged room with a four-poster bed and antique armoire. A bowl of fresh-cut flowers graced a dresser, and gorgeous French doors led out to a screened-in patio.
So, what do you think of your home away from home? Olga asked Prozac, plopping her down on the floor.
Prozac took an exploratory sniff or two, then looked up at the bed inquisitively.
What? No chocolates on the pillow?
Okay, I have no idea if that's what Prozac was thinking, but I sure was. I happen to like the whole chocolate on the pillow thing when I travel. It's so much nicer than those silly free shower caps they give you that never even begin to cover your hair.
Her litter box is out on the patio, Olga informed me, and her food and water bowls are in the bathroom. Why don't you get settled, and then I'll take you on a tour of the facilities. After that, it's cocktail hour.
She marched off with a cheery wave, her Valkyrie braid bouncing in her wake. After she left, I checked out the bathroom, impressed with its mosaic tiles and claw-footed bathtub. There, as promised, next to a pedestal sink, were a pair of earthenware bowls for Prozac. Lance had assured me the Haven would provide the best in chow for both me and my hungry roommate, and by now I was starving. I'd wanted to stop off for a burger on the drive up, but couldn't possibly prolong the agony of Prozac's wails. I thought longingly of the gourmet food sure to come. I couldn't wait to dig into the hors d'oeuvres at cocktail hour. What's more, the Haven was a mere grape's throw from the Central California wineries, so I eagerly awaited a glass of nerve-soothing Chardonnay to accompany my snacks. After hanging my clothes in a closet that smelled of lavender and mothballs, I left Prozac sunning herself on the screened-in patio and set off for a tour of the facilities, counting the milliseconds till cocktail hour.
This is my pride and joy.
Olga and I were standing in the middle of a large vegetable garden at the back of the house.
Aren't they beautiful? She asked,
gazing lovingly at the beds of lettuce, carrots, zucchini, tomatoes, and herbs at her feet. Not nearly as beautiful in my humble op as a sausage pizza dripping with cheese, but I nodded in agreement, faking a nature-loving smile.
All the produce on our menu comes from right here in this garden.
She kneeled down to fondle a tomato.
It's all organic, of course. Nothing toxic ever goes near my little angels.
She squeezed a leaf and held it under my nose. A pungent aroma assaulted my nostrils.
Cilantro, isn't it heavenly?
Frankly, I'd smelled sweat socks with a nicer bouquet. But I forced another nature-loving grin. Shooting one last tender glance at her angels, she resumed our tour, leading me out of the garden to the pool area at the rear of the house. The pool was a vintage beauty, a turquoise gem bordered with vibrant Mexican tiles. Nearby, beneath the shade of a towering pine, a jacuzzi sent plumes of steam into the cool afternoon air. Olga eyed a faded blonde who sat on a chaise reading a copy of People magazine and said to me,
So far, you and Ms. Kane are the only guests who've checked in. Let me introduce you. Hello, Kathy, she called out,
leading me over to my spa mate, who looked up from her People with pale blue eyes. From the extra padding she sported around her hip-thigh zone, I figured she was a fellow member of the Ben & Jerry fan club.
I'd like you to meet our new arrival, Jaine Austen. This is Jane's first trip to the Haven.
Kathy's eyes lit up.
Really? Me too. I've been dreaming about coming here for years, and at last I finally made it.
She gazed in awe at her bucolic surroundings.
You're going to just love everything, Jaine. Olga took me on the tour earlier. It's all so fabulous.
At 400 bucks a day, I thought, it darn well better be.
See you later for cocktails, Kathy, Olga said. Time to finish showing Jaine around.
And she was just about to lead me away when a breathy voice trilled out behind us. Yoo-hoo, Olga, honey. We turned to see a stunning, tawny-haired woman sweeping down the path with what looked like a fur muffler in her arms. Oh my gosh, Kathy gasped, fanning herself with her people. Isn't that Mallory Francis, the movie star? Olga's face clouded over.
Well, she's not exactly a star, she muttered. The woman hasn't been in a hit film in years.
True, but thanks to a series of high-profile divorces and a centerfold in Playboy, Mallory Francis had been constant tabloid fodder and the star of many a Lifetime movie, not to mention her own highly rated reality show, Mad About Mallory. Like Kathy, I'd recognized her right away. Now she came gliding over, a vision in tight white jeans and halter top, her creamy skin spray-tanned to perfection. Perched in the crook of her arms was not a muffler after all, but a wiry Pekingese whose huge brown eyes glittered with malice.
Olga, honey, Mallory cried. So wonderful to see you, Armani, she prompted her pooch. Give Olga Woga a great big kiss.
The peak let out an ominous growl, bearing a set of rather terrifying little fangs.
Bad doggy,
Mallory chided, her mouth puckered in mock disapproval. Stifling what I was certain was a growl of her own, Olga managed a stiff smile.
Welcome back to the Haven, Mallory.
So fabulous to be here.
Mallory planted an air kiss somewhere in the general vicinity of Olga's cheek.
Don't worry about showing me to my suite. I can see you have your hands full with these two nobodies.
Okay, so she didn't really call us nobodies, but I could tell that's what she was thinking by the dismissive glance she'd shot in our direction.
I'll have someone on your staff let me in, she said to Olga. But I just couldn't check in without saying hello.
She paused to look around.
The place hasn't changed a bit. That's what I love about the Haven. Other spas are constantly making improvements, but the Haven stays the same year after year.
She paused to finger a frayed piece of mesh on one of the pool chairs.
That's what makes it so charming.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but
that was a bit of a dig, Nespa.
I'm so happy you approve, Olga replied, icicles dripping from her voice.
I'd sensed friendlier vibes at a shark tank.
Well, I'm off to my suite, Mallory chirped. Send up an order of fresh mangoes, will you, hon? I've got the munchies.
And away she sailed, high heels clacking on the flagstones. Kathy stared after her, slack-jawed.
Oh my gosh, she gasped. I can't believe I get to spend a whole week with Mallory Francis.
Me neither, Olga said with a weary sigh. Me neither.
The next stop on our itinerary was the Spa Therapy Center. A squat box of a building, clearly built decades after the main house, it held a rabbit warren of massage rooms, separated down the middle by a narrow corridor. At one end of the corridor sat a large urn, which was where, according to Olga, the Haven's special muscle-relaxing tea, imported all the way from Tibet, was served daily. Olga showed me one of the massage rooms, a no-frills affair featuring a massage table, supply cabinet, and, over in the corner of the room, a large metal vat. At first, I thought it might be some kind of high-tech hamper, but then Olga said,
That's where we keep the seaweed for our detoxifying seaweed wraps.
Seaweed wraps?
The only wraps I knew involved lunch meat and pita bread.
They suck up all the nasty toxins from your body,
Most ordinary spas use a paste for their seaweed wraps, but here at the Haven, we add real seaweed for extra detoxification.
With that, she lifted the lid and hauled out an enormous piece of bull kelp. The kind you see strung along the shoreline after a storm, usually buzzing with sandflies.
It's been thoroughly sterilized, Olga assured me, and preserved in a protein-enriched brine. You can't imagine how wonderful it feels to be wrapped up with one of these babies for 45 minutes.
Now I'm as fond of a dip in the ocean as the next guy. So long as the next guy isn't the captain of the Titanic. But the last thing I wanted was to get up close and personal with a piece of algae. But I nodded as if I actually believed her.
Okay, she said, returning the kelp to its brine. Now it's time for a tour of the kitchen.
At last, she was talking my language. Chapter 3 The Haven's gourmet chef turned out to be a gawky teenager named Kevin. He was busy chopping vegetables when Olga and I showed up in the kitchen, a huge, outdated affair whose fixtures looked like they'd been installed sometime in the Coolidge administration.
I'm between chefs right now, Olga explained, and Kevin has been helping me out after school. He's really marvelously talented.
With the experience I gain here, he told me solemnly from beneath a mop of unruly bangs, I hope someday to get a job at Applebee's.
So much for gourmet dining. But I didn't mind. At home, my idea of fine dining is adding Dijon mustard to my quarter pounder, so I was certainly up for some simple fare. A T-bone smothered in A1 steak sauce would suit me just fine.
Mallory Francis and her people showed up a little while ago, Kevin said.
I know, Olga sighed.
I took them to their rooms.
He hacked away at some cilantro.
Mallory stiffed me on the tip.
What a surprise, Olga muttered.
And she wants mangoes for dessert tonight. She said to be sure they're fresh.
I'll bet she did, Olga said, a tiny vein beginning to throb in her forehead.
She reached for a big bottle of pills on the large pine island that dominated the kitchen.
Vitamins, she said, popping two of them in her mouth. Have to keep up my energy.
Meanwhile, I was busy sniffing the room for any signs of dinner in the oven. But all I could smell was that damn cilantro. Oh well, maybe there were steaks marinating in the fridge, or chicken breasts smothered in barbecue sauce, or perhaps a nice cheesy lasagna just waiting to be popped in the oven. My food fantasies were interrupted when Olga thrust a piece of paper in my hand.
Here's a copy of tonight's menu.
Now, my heart didn't actually stop when I read that menu, but it came pretty darn close. Kel nightmare. A depressing 300-calorie affair. It featured fresh garden salad, vegetable medley, and two words that sent my taste buds running for cover. Steamed fish. What can I say? Unless it's lobster dripping with butter, I am not a fish fan. And steamed fish? That meant no outside crispy stuff, just inside fishy stuff. Yuck. Olga, I said, when I finally managed to regain my powers of speech. I think there's been a bit of a mistake here.
What's wrong? Did I misspell medley again?
No. I'm here for the regular menu, the one with the steaks and pasta.
Steaks and pasta?
Olga laughed gaily.
There are no steaks and pasta, Jaine. Didn't you know? The Haven is a strict diet retreat. All our guests get 900 low-carb calories a day.
I most certainly did not know this joint was a diet place. Au contraire, Lance had been raving up his wazoo about what divine food they had. If I'd had any idea that I'd be giving up edible food for the next week, I would never have agreed to come. I mean, why on earth would I want to hang out at a place that did not believe in the dessert fairy? I'm sorry, I said,
but you're just going to have to issue my friend a refund. I'm checking out.
No can do, Olga replied, her Valkyrie arms clamped firmly across her chest. We don't issue refunds here at the Haven.
Oh, crud. This place must have cost Lance a small fortune. I couldn't let all that money go to waste. The least I could do was stick it out for a few days. And so, in a moment to be filed in my worst decisions ever department, I said, okay, I'll give it a try. Back at my room, I found Prozac stretched out on the patio flagstones, soaking up the sun. Horrible news, Pro, I moaned, slumping down on the chaise next to her. The Haven is a 900-calorie-a-day diet spa. How on earth am I going to live on 900 itsy-bitsy calories a day? She looked up at me in that comforting way of hers, as if to say, you could start by giving me a belly rub. 900 calories, most of them from smelly green stuff. And while you're at it, could you scratch me behind my ears? That's a whole week without the three basic food groups, chocolate, pizza, and chunky monkey. I don't feel you scratching. My God, Pro, don't you see what this means? I'm in diet hell. She peered at me through slitted eyes. Aw, quit your beefing. If you ask me, this place is heaven. Why can't we have a patio like this at home? At which point, my pity party was interrupted by a knock on my door. Wearily, I dredged myself out of the chaise and went to get it. I opened the door to find Olga standing there, with what looked like a fishing rod in one hand and an oversized hamster wheel in the other.
Your cat's too fat, she announced without preamble.
Out on the patio, Prozac looked up in surprise. Surely you can't mean moi.
She needs to work out, so I brought her some exercise equipment. This, Olga said, dropping the oversized hamster wheel on the carpet, is a kiddie treadmill. And this?
She waved the fishing rod, which I now saw had some fake feathers hanging from it,
is a whirly bird.
If you squinted really hard and were standing in the next county, the feathers on the fishing rod vaguely resembled a bird.
Yes, she said. We'll whittle those ugly pounds off the two of you in no time.
Someone certainly flunked out of tact 101. Olga marched out to the patio and, scooping Prozac into her arms, brought her back inside. Prozac bristled with annoyance. Hey, wait a minute. I was in the middle of a very important nap. Then she wriggled free from Olga's grasp and jumped to the floor, heading back out to the patio. But Olga quickly shut the patio door, closing off her escape route, and began waving the whirly bird.
Watch, she said. She'll think it's a bird and go chasing after it.
As if. Prozac took one look at that thing in action and practically rolled her eyes in disbelief. Lady, you gotta be kidding. If that's a bird, I'm an Airedale. With that, she plopped down on the carpet and began an intense perusal of her genitals.
That's funny, Olga mused. Most cats go crazy over the whirly bird.
Prozac's not like most cats.
So I see. A little slow, is she?
Honestly, sometimes I swear Prozac understands English. She actually tore herself away from her genitals long enough to give Olga a most unfriendly hiss. I can't say I blamed her. Prozac is not the least bit slow, I said, leaping to my pampered princess's defense. She happens to be smarter than many people I know, several of whom I might add are currently serving in Congress.
Well, let's try the kitty treadmill, Olga chirped, her enthusiasm undampened.
Snatching Prozac from her genital exam, she deposited her on the treadmill. It was a lot like the exercise wheels you see in hamster cages, only instead of wire, the track was solid wood.
Now, we'll just tempt her with a dietetic kitty treat.
Olga pulled out a small can of something called cardio catnips and placed a few on the treadmill.
Made with no artificial colors, no artificial flavors, no artificial preservatives.
Actually, I pointed out, those happen to be three of her favorite things. Prozac, who has been known to nosh on unwashed gym socks, sniffed at the cardio nips in disgust, and then curled up on the treadmill to resume her perusal of her privates.
She'll get the hang of it, Olga said. You've just got to be firm with her.
And then, her voice dripping with disapproval, she added,
She didn't get this fat without an enabler.
Of all the nerve! By now, I felt like hissing at her myself.
I almost forgot, Olga said. Her cat food.
She trotted out to the hallway and carted in a basket of canned cat food.
It's a low-cal, low-fat, vitamin-enriched, hairball control formula with special enzymes to promote healthy digestion.
Prozac eyed it warily as Olga popped the pull tab and held it under her nose. This was the last straw. One sniff and Prozac bolted across the room to hide under the bed. Never had I seen her so freaked. This is a cat who never hides under the bed, not even during an earthquake.
A lot of cats don't like it at first, Olga said, but she'll get used to it in no time. Especially, she sneered, when there's nothing else to eat.
Then, smiling what I considered a most sadistic smile, she headed for the door. Good heavens, the woman was a regular diet Nazi. The minute she was gone, Prozac poked her head out from under the dust ruffle and stared up at me with frantic green eyes. We gotta break out of this dump. Chapter 4 I headed over to the lounge for cocktail hour, praying that actual cocktails would be served. If not cocktails, a simple glass of wine. Surely Olga could spare 100 or so calories on some Chardonnay.
Not bloody likely.
The cocktail Olga thrust into my hand when I showed up was a puke green concoction called a celery fizz, half celery juice, half club soda, and a sprig of arugula, for those of you masochistic enough to try it.
Bottoms up, Olga commanded.
Good heavens, the woman actually expected me to drink it. I took a tentative sip, prompting my taste buds to recoil in horror. I do not exaggerate when I say the stuff tasted like carbonated lawn clippings. Not that I've ever tasted lawn clippings, but they can't possibly be worse than that ghastly celery fizz. I thought about tossing it into a nearby potted palm when Olga wasn't looking, but I was afraid it might kill the palm.
Let me introduce you to everyone, Olga said, as she ushered me into the lounge,
where overstuffed armchairs and sofas shrouded in shabby chic slipcovers were scattered about like huge chintz mushrooms. Kathy, the pale blonde I'd met at the pool, was sitting in one of the chairs near the fireplace, watching a rather anemic fire as it sputtered to stay alive.
Hi, Jaine,
she said, catching sight of me. I waved hello as Olga led me past her to meet two more fellow inmates who were sitting together on a love seat.
Jaine, meet Harvey, Mallory Francis's personal hairstylist.
A reed-thin guy clad in fashionably wrinkled linen beamed me a dazzling smile.
Love your hair, sweetheart,
he said, eyeing my mop of unruly curls.
It's so nouveau Harpo Marx.
I suspected that was a bit of a slam, but I decided to take the high road and smiled anyway.
And this?
Olga nodded at the woman sitting next to Harvey, a dour gal with wire-rimmed glasses and what I would soon discover was a permanent scowl.
Is Kendra, Mallory's personal assistant.
Kendra grunted a curt hello, her lips puckered in a sour expression. But that, of course, might have been due to the celery fizz.
Come sit by me, Jaine.
Kathy beckoned from across the room, patting the armchair next to her. Sensing Kendra was not enamored of my company, I took Kathy up on her offer and trotted over to join her.
"We're closer to the snacks over here,"
Kathy whispered as I sat down next to her. The snacks to which she referred, set out on a coffee table in front of us, were a depressing collection of carrot and celery sticks, garnished with some carelessly washed radishes.
"This is going to be a lot harder than I thought," Kathy said, picking up a celery stick with a sigh. "But it's all going to be worth it in the end. I intend to drop at least 5 pounds while I'm here. Gosh, I still can't believe I'm actually staying at the Haven."
"It's unbelievable, all right," I muttered.
"I thought I'd die when I realized Mallory Francis was here, too. I see her all the time at work."
"You work for her, too?" I blinked, puzzled.
"Oh, I don't see her in person. I see her picture in the tabloids. I'm a supermarket checker, which isn't easy. I can tell you, standing next to those candy bar racks all day, it's no wonder I've put on a few pounds over the years. Sometimes, I think of chucking it all and going into cosmetology, but I can't risk losing my pension. Oh well, only 12 more years till retirement, but who's counting, huh? So, what kind of work do you do, Jaine?"
It took me a while to realize she'd actually taken time out from her bio to ask me a question. "Me? I'm a writer."
"A writer? Oh my gosh! First a TV movie star, and now a writer. What books have you written?"
I was about to tell her I was not a novelist, but a freelance copywriter, and as such, the only book I'd ever written was a stirring opus for Toilet Master's plumbers called You and Your Septic Tank. But I never did get a chance to break the disappointing news, because just then, Mallory Francis made her grand entrance. And I do mean grand.
"Sorry I'm late, everybody,"
she crooned from the doorway. All eyes were riveted on her as she came sailing into the room, on legs that wouldn't quit, her tawny mane of sun-streaked hair billowing out behind her. My God, the woman was a walking Victoria's Secret commercial. Perched in the crook of her arm was her petulant peak.
"Say hello to everyone, Armani,"
Mallory prompted. Armani gave an angry yip, eyeing us with the imperious air of a dog who'd been a third-world despot in a former life. Both Mallory and the Peak wore matching turquoise t-shirts emblazoned with rhinestone lettering that said, "Danger, high maintenance."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.